Hey guys, welcome to another special, well, every episode of Blush and Beauty, the web's premier podcast about makeup, is special. But this one is extra special. Do you know why, Stan?
Nah.
Well, I'm going to tell you why. Because we at Blush and Beauty have formed a very special partnership with Bota Box, which I know all of our listeners know about, the monthly beauty box that you pay low, low price of $39.99, and then they just mail you, like, a bunch of random samples in a box, and you can just be like, wow, this doesn't work at all with my skin tone, and I don't even wear this kind of makeup, but this is cool, this is a good value. Like, you know Bota Box, you know Stan, right? Right? It's a good product. It's a good product, because they work with us.
Okay.
And we have picked out...
Yep.
So the special... I don't know why you don't know about this. This is kind of... This doesn't make any sense. But we've picked out a lot of special makeup brand things. It's colors that we think are great for everyone to use. So we're going to tell you a little bit about those today. This one is an eyeliner. It's called Sawdust. It's got a really distinct... beige color that really, it just blends really well, you know?
Wait, why would you want your eyeliner to blend with your skin?
Well, if you can blend it, what I mean is you can blend it with other eyeliner.
Why wouldn't I just, I don't understand.
Because sometimes you want to mix the beige eyeliner with this sparkly eyeliner. This one's called Phantom Dust.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a really good, if you blend them together, they look really, that's why I put them both in Blush and Beauty's secret special Bota Box, the monthly delivery service for garbage.
Wait, I thought you said it's not garbage.
I said it's a great service. I just said that. I said it's a great, worthwhile service.
Oh, okay.
And this one's my personal favorite. This is a special color of concealer. Here, it's just, I love, they gave us the ability to also name all of these, and it's got our name right, it's beautiful. Stan, what, read us the, it's just wonderful. Read us the name of this concealer. Just tell us what it, just read this to the people.
It's what's a concealer? I don't even, anyway, it's called Deep Dish Skillet Cookie.
You're right, Stan? It is? That's exactly what it's called. You nailed it. Oh, so if you guys want to also wear Deep Dish Skillet Cookie, here's what you gotta do. Go to BotaBox.com, sign up for the monthly box, it's $39.99, right? And then after you get your first box, go to the website and go to your profile and say, I want to sign up for an extra special box. And then scroll through all the hundreds of... and just get to the Blush and Beauty one. Give them an extra $20. And then the next box you get will be a different box. And if you go to the website and say, hey, this is the secret box you sent me, they say, okay, well, you got the secret code. Now we can send you Blush and Beauty's box.
That's true.
And that's how you get... that's how you'll be able to get your full-size sample of Deep Dish Skillet Cookie. The concealer. If you look. Oh, man. Oh, dude. Okay. Real talk, though, Stan. If your skin looks more similar to a Deep Dish Skillet Cookie than skin... that you need to conceal blemishes with it. You got problems, bro.
You right.
Dude.
You right.
Oh, man. Whew. All right.
Hey.
I think we're ready to do the Bear vs. Bandcast, video game podcast about video games. The video game podcast about video games and also nothing. Man, when I was, like, thinking of that, like, little gag, whatever you want to call that, that bit,
Yeah.
I was like, man, I think Bota Box is like a real thing. Like, I think it's like an actual service or something.
There is something like, that gets you makeup to your house.
Oh, there's more than one thing, for sure. But I couldn't remember what it was called because I don't know. Like, I don't know.
Right.
And so, I don't think, apparently I never knew because I looked up Bota Box. And I was like, if it's something real, I don't necessarily want to use it. Like, you know. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And Bota Box is a brand of boxed wine. So that's how I knew what that was.
Okay. All right.
And so I was just like, well, I have to use that now because that just is perfect.
That works. Yeah.
Okay. We got it out of our system a little bit. I think we're ready to talk about video games and video game related content. And I think we're also ready to introduce ourselves.
Oh. All right. I'm Ryan.
I'm Nick.
This is the Bear vs. Mancast.
And we're going to talk about video games.
This is deep dish skillet cookies.
Apparently, yeah.
Why is it the funniest thing I've ever said on this podcast?
I don't know. Because we were expecting you, we were not expecting you to say deep dish skillet cookie.
Nobody was.
Oh, okay. So today is October 21st. It's an early podcast week, kind of, for us.
Do you know what else today is, Nick?
Episode 30, the recording of the episode 35 of the Bear vs. Mancast.
It's also another thing.
I think it might be PewDiePie's girlfriend's birthday.
Yep, that was it.
Either that or it was yesterday. One of the two. Hey, okay, so they live in the UK, right?
Yes.
Where's the international dateline?
I'm not sure.
Is it between us and the UK? No, right?
No, I think it's
I'm thinking of the Grand Meridian.
It's basically between Alaska and Russia.
Oh, okay.
Like basically.
Yeah, I think her birthday was yesterday.
Okay.
Shout out. Happy birthday, PewDiePie's girlfriend. Yeah, cuz I think
no,
you know
it's
what
today.
I'm thinking of?
It's today.
Her I birthday? It.
Yeah.
Oh, happy... Well, by the time you hear this, it's going to be belated, because she's a big fan of the show.
That's true. PewDiePie's girlfriend, this is the only podcast she subscribes to. So.
It's funny. Even though he has a podcast, she doesn't listen to that fucking trash.
Wait, PewDiePie has a podcast?
Actually, I don't know if he does it anymore.
Oh, well, fuck that guy.
He did it at one point.
All right.
Because he just has to have his fingers in all of the pies. So what I was thinking of when I thought the international dateline was like in the Atlantic Ocean, I was thinking of the Grand Meridian.
Mm.
Which is like a little bit west of like the UK, I think, and that's like the point that's like zero.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, that's zero time. That's like plus like we're minus 3 hours from Grand Meridian time.
Oh, I think we're minus 5 hours.
Well, yeah, but we're minus something, and then like Europe is plus a couple.
Plus. Mm.
That's what I was thinking when I think of the international daylight. That'd be crazy though if we just crossed the Atlantic Ocean and it was tomorrow.
That'd be nuts.
Yeah. You know, else is nuts.
What?
Sandwiches.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Should we talk about sandwiches again?
We can. I had a sandwich tonight, so...
Oh, man. I don't think I had any sandwiches. Well, I've eaten... I had sandwiches at work, but those don't count. I just eat those for sustenance.
Mm. Truth.
They mean nothing to me.
Truth.
Did I have any sandwiches? I have any sandwiches. One time I took, so at some point today, or this past week, I had some pumpkin butter, mm-hmm. from Trader Joe's pumpkin butter, and I was like, man, I want to eat this, but I don't have anything to do with it.
So you just stuck a spoon in that bad boy and went to town?
No, because the jar is big enough that I probably could have just knocked that out in one sitting if I really did it that way.
Mm-hmm.
No, I spread it on like a flatbread.
Okay.
Not like a pizza or something, but just like a flat bread.
Okay.
I put it on there, I warmed it up in the microwave, and I rolled it up.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just ate it. It was pretty good.
Okay. It's not
pretty
right.
good. It was pumpkin buttery.
Mm-hmm.
I like pumpkin.
Pumpkin's okay.
Pumpkin spice things are good, but ultimately, like, sometimes I just want pumpkin.
I like pumpkin. I don't like pumpkin spice.
I like some things that are pumpkin spice. You ever had cookie butter from Trader Joe's?
I don't shop at Trader Joe's, so...
I wouldn't say I shop at Trader Joe's either, but I've had cookie butter.
The last time I went to Trader Joe's, was in San Diego.
You know, last time I went to Trader Joe's, oh, that's because that's all they got over there. One time I went to a Trader Joe's when I was in San Diego. That one time I was in San Diego, which was like 3 years ago to the day.
Yeah.
I literally think like today was the day that we hung out in San Diego 3 years ago.
That might be true.
I'm going to just double check this because Time Hop is a good... Bear's Mancast brought to you by Time Hop, the app. It's free.
Fact. I want to eat minestrone.
I checked 3 years ago today. It was a Sunday. I checked in at Lolita's Taco Shop on Yelp. Oh, and okay. Also Tajima Noodle House.
Oh, we went there.
Yeah, we did. And we had like tall Sapporos.
Oh, dude, it is 3 years ago.
3 years ago, exactly.
Fuck, memories.
I lost the story that I was talking about. Oh, yeah, I went to that Trader Joe's.
Yeah.
And we're just like, my parents and I were just like, I was like, I think my mom was asking about snacks or something. Or like, someone recommended to her some like dried chocolate covered acai berry snacks or something like that. And he goes, like, the dude was seriously like the most legit like surfer dude I've ever seen in my entire life. Like, he was completely unironically like, the shaggy blonde hair, and like he was like, oh yeah, dude, like he basically along the lines of like, he's like, oh yeah, man, when I get some of those chocolate covered whatever snacks, whatever, like, dude, I'll just like rage on a whole bag by myself, bro. Like, he did, like, that's basically, I'm paraphrasing.
Yeah, that's a real person you can see in California.
I couldn't believe it. Yeah, like I thought those people were just myths, just like how people in California are probably just like, there's no such thing as a New Yorker. Those are just, like, funny movie tale people. And then you go to New York, and you're just like, oh, okay. Oh, they're everywhere. All right. But, yeah, that's pretty much the extent of it. I'm sure I've had another sandwich. I'm trying to think really hard, but
I had a sandwich.
Is an apple pie a sandwich?
No. It's a pie.
It's between two pieces of bread.
Pie crust.
Stuff. Yeah, pie crust, kind of like bread.
Do you put a top crust on your apple pie?
Oh, every time.
I don't think I do.
What, do you go like crumble?
No.
Like a crumble on it?
I think I just don't put a thing on top.
What? That's not a pie then.
Totally a pie.
That's like a reverse pot pie at that point.
Top crust is not pie.
You gotta have something on top. You gotta put like a crumble. You gotta put
pie don't got nothing on top, motherfucker.
Pecan pie got pecans on top.
That's not how that works. Then that's like sugar pie with pecans.
Well, the pecans are in the filling, but you also have to put the pecans on top because A, you want the person eating it to know that it's pecan pie.
See, we don't put pecans inside.
I'm sorry, what?
Traditional like Ryan's mom's pecan pie is like a filling that consists of mostly brown sugar and dates.
Oh, okay. And then, how about corn syrup?
There might be
dark. Yeah, syrup. I think you gotta have corn syrup in there to make it like nice and solid and stuff.
Yeah. And then we just sprinkle pecans over it, like an ass load. I'm sure like some of them like sink into the filling because physics.
But well, a lot of them stay on top, and they're the top crust of that pie.
Yeah, but I don't...
So you really just... You do, like, an open-face pie?
I don't even...
Like, you just put a one thing in the bottom, one pie crust in the bottom. You fill it full of apples and just put it in the oven.
Okay,
the apples wouldn't even cook properly.
See, I don't even know, because I don't make pie. So I might be, like, full of shit.
Very possible.
See, all I know is that my mom wouldn't, like, she probably wouldn't take the time to make two pie crusts.
A lot of pie crust recipes, I find, come with two. Like, it makes enough for two.
Oh. But then you gotta, like, roll out two. I think she's like, fuck apple pie, and she just makes apple crumble. It's way easier.
Yeah, you can make, like, apple crisp. You can make apple crisp in the microwave, for God's sakes. Like, yeah, whatever. You know, you do you.
Yeah, you do.
All I'm saying is just keep it 100. You make an apple pie.
Keep it 100.
Keep it 100. That's all I'm trying to say.
Keep your shit tight.
All I'm saying is that when you're podcasting, just keep it video games.
Oh, we haven't.
Real quick though, that sandwich.
Uh huh.
Hit me. What really is gonna be taste?
Okay. So I'm experiment. This is a longer conversation.
Oh, shit.
I fucked up. But so, I'm experimenting with turkey breasts because at Thanksgiving we do this thing where I separate the dark meat from the white meat before I cook it.
Right. Okay.
In order to, because they cook at different times.
They do. You're right.
So if you have the means to remove your legs and thighs from your breast from your turkey, I highly recommend you do so. Anywho, so
you brine them both in the same solution?
So last year, yes, but this year I'm going to sous vide the turkey breast.
Ryan, you're a madman, you know that?
Yeah.
You and your family turned Thanksgiving into a freaking Olympic event.
It's the only holiday that matters. Like, straight up. All the other holidays are, like, totally negotiable. Like, we can make this, we can do that, blah, blah, blah. Nothing matters. Like, I think this year on Christmas Eve we're having lasagna. Because, fuck it, who cares?
Christmas Day, my family and I, we eat pizza.
That's fucking sick.
And one time my mom was like, how about we don't get pizza? And I was like, what? What are you talking about? How is that even possible to celebrate Christmas without getting pizza?
This is how we have Christmas, Mom.
And she was like, she's like, I didn't know you cared so much. I was like, yes, of course.
Of course, Mom.
I had to have dump cake on my birthday. I had to have pizza on Christmas.
The fuck's dump cake?
Oh, man. Now that's a conversation. All
right.
Dump cake. Okay, here's dump cake. Okay. It's like a golden cake mix. It's golden cake mix, cherry pie filling, a can of crushed pineapple, and butter.
Have I ever eaten this dump cake from you?
I bet you have.
Was I a small child?
No, I've literally had it every year on my birthday for, like, the past 15 years, at least. Maybe not 15, but there's one time, like, within the past 10 years, I was just like, Mom, this is what it's going to be every year. So, like, even so much as when I was at school, they came to visit me on my birthday and brought me dump cake. Sick. Or, like, My mom was in Philadelphia for my birthday this past year.
Mm-hmm.
My dad went to go visit, and she made dump cake there and sent it back home with him 6 hours in a car to bring it to me. Because dump cake matters, bro.
Dump cake matters. That's it.
Hashtag dump cake matters.
So anyway, I sous-vided a turkey breast.
Sous-vided it? You okay?
I sous-vided the turkey breast. It came out pretty good. I want to make some minor adjustments.
Did you sear it?
So what I did was I put it in a bag. I sprinkled salt and pepper on it. I sous-vided it for 3 hours at 135 degrees Fahrenheit.
That's not hot enough.
It is hot enough. And then I took it out of the bag, I preheated the oven to 500 degrees, and I shoved that in there.
It got to 165 in how long? How long?
You can't
eat it then.
Oh no, okay, so real talk. You can serve a chicken that's cooked to 135 if that chicken has been cooking for 3 hours.
Bullshit. I'm never eating your chicken.
I'm fucking
just kidding.
Do you want an FDA chart? Because I'll get you one.
Yeah, actually, that makes me feel a lot better. I'm kind of a germaphobe when it comes to that kind of stuff.
I'll get you one. Anyway, so I've been eating that. I made a turkey sandwich with, like, mayonnaise and,
Man, what a way to ruin that sandwich.
And, but it was, like, curried mayonnaise, and then I put, like...
Huh.
I kind of made, like, turkey salad, but, like, I didn't. So, like, I just, like, sprinkled some pecans on there. And some, like, craisins. It was kind of good.
I was going to say, like, you got to get some cranberries or raisins or grapes or something in there.
Yeah. I put some craisins in there.
What kind of bread are we talking about?
All I had was a hoagie roll.
So, when in Rome.
When in Rome.
A hoagie roll, you eat a hoagie roll. Like, what's in the fridge right now? Got hoagie rolls?
I got hoagie roll. I don't keep my bread in the fridge. What are you doing?
Oh, no, of course not. I'm just saying, like, you look around, you're like, what we got around here? Like, what we got? We got hoagie rolls. We got meatballs. And we got Dijon mustard. Boom.
Done.
Dijon mustard meatball subs. Keep it 100.
Mm-hmm.
I still don't believe you about 135 turkey breast, though.
Hey, man.
It's gross. You're going to kill everybody. millions are dead. video games.
Oh, dude.
Video games. You played video games this week.
I did.
Somehow you found time between sous-viding turkey breast to improper temperatures. You found time to play video games and also keep it 100, which is good.
I kept it 100. That's good.
You played 100 video games.
I'm going to take a picture of this graph and then send it to you via text
message. Do it.
It's very insightful.
Do you want to tell about the video games? You want to tell the people about the video games now?
Do you want to talk about a game we both played?
Yep.
Okay. We played Downwell.
Yeah, we sure did.
I played a lot more of it than you did, I think.
Yes. That is true. I feel like Downwell... So when I saw Downwell was out...
Game of the year?
It jogged my memory in a weird way. I had, deja vu, but I don't think I've ever seen this game before, but I feel like...
You didn't go to PAX, did you? No, you didn't.
Not this past year.
I played it at PAX, so that's how I knew about it.
Maybe you told me about it when you got back from PAX East?
I think I did.
Check the tape.
No,
that's going to take way too long.
I think I did. Yeah. So I played a bunch of this game, and I was kind of like lukewarm on it at PAX East because I had to play it on the phone.
I'm pretty sure that is how I know about it because you told me about it.
Yeah, I think I told you about it. So I had to play it on a phone because that's what they had. And I was like, oh, this is okay. It plays like a phone game, so I hate it. So I was like,
it's like a deep dish skillet cookie. This is garbage.
So like fast forward to like a week ago and I follow, I think it's Devolver Digital on Twitter.
Yeah.
Because they make a lot of games that I like, apparently.
They're a publisher.
Well, they publish a lot of games that I like.
That is factual. Cause that's what confused me about it. I was like, why have I heard of this game? You're like, oh, Devolver Digital made it. And I was like, what?
No, they didn't, you stupid piece of shit, Ryan.
It's like they do publish, like, they publish all of Lambier's games.
Oh, really?
For the most part. They do good stuff. They do good work.
So they were like, oh, man, Downwell's out. And I'm like, sick, because they was like, it's out on iOS and PC. So I bought it on PC, and I dumped, like, 7 hours into it this past week.
Really?
I played a lot of this game.
That's a lot of that game.
Yeah, I did good. I think that game is great. Okay, so Downwell, if you guys don't know, because you might not, that's why you're here.
$4, go know it.
No, it's $3.
It's $3, you should definitely go know it. All I'm saying is that if you guys truly are dedicated to keeping it 100, you're going to buy Downwell. And if you're a really cool guy, you're going to buy it twice like we both did.
I did. I definitely did that. So, Downwell is a roguelite game.
Okay, stop right there.
Yes.
Well, when you have like a stopwatch, you do like a lap break or whatever.
Okay,
sure. Put one there. Continue.
Okay. It's got some really great super like Game Boy inspired pixel art. It's got like two or three colors depending on the color palette that you're using. Actually, it might only have two colors.
Two of those colors are always black and white.
It might have two or three. I don't know. Anyway, it's super old school looking. The soundtrack's pretty great. The gameplay is you are literally falling down a well, and you can jump and shoot. And you have, like, gun boots, and you always shoot down.
So that's the genius of this game, in my opinion, is its simplicity.
Mm-hmm.
You can move left, and you can move right. And then there's a button.
Yep.
And the button causes you to jump when you're standing on something.
Yep.
Or if you're in the air, it fires your gun boots. And there's different gun boot weapons, and they fire all... You know, some are semi-automatic, some are fully automatic, some are stupid.
Hey, you know what? There's not that many weapons, and that makes me really happy.
That is good, but sometimes you get noppy, and you're just like...
I like noppy, personally.
I don't like noppy.
Man, that game is really good.
That game is really good.
Oh, that game is really good. And I got, like, into the zone, like, I think, I don't know, probably Sunday. or so, where I just, like, I played this game for, like, 3 hours, and I was just, like, making moves, and I'm, like, bouncing off this turtle, and then, like, shooting that blob in the face, and then I go to the next part, it's full, like, ghosts and shit, shooting down, getting upgrades. I had, like, 9 health in one run.
Damn, son.
It was good.
Did you mention the fact that it's called Downwell because you go down a well?
I think I mentioned you go down in a well, but I didn't explicitly state.
Because that's why they call it Downwell. And that's pretty good. It's a pretty good name for your game about going down a well.
It's no funny business. It's just you're going down well.
We're going to go down to that previous lap that I mentioned.
Oh, is it roguelite?
Yes. Please tell me why this game is a roguelite and not just an arcade-style game.
Oh, good distinction.
Well, let's see if it's a good distinction.
I mean, the only thing, the only cause I have is that you keep your total gem count to unlock color palettes, but it doesn't actually do anything for you. Besides, it does unlock
new styles that way too.
Yeah, styles are like different ways that your dude does stuff. So, like, one of them is called Boulder. It doesn't change anything about the way he moves, but you get 6 HP instead of 4. But at the cost of you only get to pick between 2 upgrades in between each level instead of 3.
Interesting. Yeah, did you mention those upgrades
between each level? So between each level, you can pick anywhere from like 2 to 4 upgrades, depending on what upgrades and styles you're playing on, and they do things like give you a laser sight that helps aim and stuff, or beep boop, I'm a drone, motherfucker.
Oh, that's my favorite. Beep boop, hello, I'm a drone.
Yep, that's
the, that's the whole description you get. Like, they usually give you like a vague description of what they do. It's just beep boop, hello, I'm a drone. And a little drone just follows you around and shoots when you do.
Yep.
Which I find to be very useful.
Good stuff. There's also one that lets you like eat dead bodies to regain health, which is pretty sick.
And not weird. Definitely not weird.
Definitely not weird. You can definitely eat ghosts. That's not weird either.
So, as for the distinction between an arcade-style game and roguelite, I haven't really come to any conclusions, too. But I was kind of just like, when you said, like, man, I can't believe I'm considering a roguelite as my favorite game this year. And I was just like, what? The areas are randomly generated, which you want to associate with a roguelite. But arcade-style games can do that, too. Like, actual arcade games don't do that. Like, you know, if you play Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for the arcade cabinet, like, it's always the same levels.
Do you happen to know offhand if games like, I don't know, like Galaga are like, randomly generated? Or is each level set?
I think they're set. Like, some games, I'm sure, have different enemy variations. But I bet they're just picking from a set. There's not really, like, a randomly generated element. So maybe that is the distinction, but like also, what about the game Pac-Man 256? I don't know why I just thought of this, but Pac-Man 256.
I haven't played that game, so I don't know.
But I told you, like, you basically... Okay, let me think of a game. I can't think of a game. That's all I can think of is right now. I'm trying to think of a game that, like... Or Crossy Road. That's randomly generated. Like, each area you go to, like, each time you start the game, there's different configurations of cars and lily pads and logs and stuff like that. But when you die, you get to keep your coins to unlock new pieces. So is that a roguelite?
I don't know.
I think maybe what makes it a... I don't know. I think an argument could really be made either way. I think something that's kind of in the favor of roguelite is just the fact that there are upgrades.
I guess
like,
so.
Like, yeah. Your character becomes more powerful over the course of the game, and then when you die, you start over at zero again. No upgrades. I think maybe that would be the biggest distinction as to what would make it roguelite, but I also would entertain any argument just saying, well, it's just an arcade-style game. It's just like a fun, short round. The rounds actually can get pretty long.
Yeah.
But
like, I don't know, man. It's, I mean, if you want to go by popular user-defined tags for this product, roguelite is one of them. So, the populace seems to think, but I don't know, man.
If anything, it is a very light roguelite.
Yeah.
Because it's not... maybe. Sure. Like, I'm not offended by people calling it that. It is kind of that. But it's also... Like, people try a little bit too hard sometimes to call things roguelikes or roguelite, like, because that's popular.
Yeah.
But sometimes you just don't need to call it that. Like, you don't.
I don't know. I feel like procedural generation is, like, the fundamental thing.
Yeah, I think so. I think also being able to, like, level up or become stronger is also really important. Because if you just had a game, like, if you were just Galaga where all the power-ups are, like, temporary until you die.
Yeah.
That would just be an arcade game.
I guess. Or,
like, UN Squadron.
Yeah, UN Squadron.
Actually, I think, can't you, like, buy persistent upgrades in that game, or am I thinking of a different game?
Ryan doesn't know. I never got good enough of that game to, like, figure out how it works.
It's too bad you own that game.
I know.
So my experience with Downwell is that I was like, well, I'm obsessed with iOS games, so I'll buy this on iOS. And then was just, at first I was like, wow, this controls better than I thought it would. Mm-hmm. And also worse than I thought it would. Because, like, sometimes it wouldn't do what I wanted it to do.
Yeah. I found that with the iOS version
a little bit. I'd be, like, too far to the left or something. And then some other times I'd be like, how far left is too far to the left? I'd intentionally be, like, too far to the left.
Yeah.
And it worked anyways. I was like, what is making this work or not work? Or I swear I would, like, go to jump off of a block and it would, like, press the button twice. So I would just do, like, a quick hop and then start shooting and break the block.
Right.
It didn't work the way it needed to work because it's a fairly precise game.
Yes, it's actually pretty precise.
Especially like even with just 4 lives to go on, like you can get hit 4 times and then that's just game over. So I was like, I bought some games on Steam that I was putting off buying because I don't know, I was wanted them to be on sale or something. But then I was like, I'm just gonna buy them because I am going to buy them eventually and they're not even expensive, so whatever.
Yeah,
and one of those games was Downwell, and I played it for the first time, like, 2 hours ago on Steam with a 360 controller. Holy crap, the world of difference that makes.
Yep.
It's a little bit, sometimes I forget the fact that it's still only left, right, and A. Like, I can't press up to talk to the shopkeeper. And like, this is an iOS game. It's also very much, like, framed like an iOS game. And I don't like buying iOS games on Steam.
You mean like the literal like frame of the action? Is that what you're talking about?
Okay. Yeah. And specifically, I'm bothered when I go to buy a game on Steam and then I find out that it's an iOS game. I'm just like, crap, why didn't I just buy this on iOS? Not so with this game. It's like the first time I've ever been like, I'm glad that I... Because it's also the same cost.
Right.
Same price for both versions. Some people go like, well, I ported my iOS game to Steam, so I have to charge like $2 more or something.
Right.
Although usually when they come to Steam, any games that have microtransactions in them are devoid of them suddenly because it's harder to implement.
Right.
So that's a good thing, but definitely if you're on the fence, I mean, you can attest to the fact that Downwell runs on a toaster. Yes.
Downwell runs on a toaster.
So, if you have a Steam account, just buy Downwell, bro. I bet even playing with your keyboard works great.
Yeah, I think it's like Z and C and left and right arrows.
You can also play A and D and Shift.
Mm.
But, you know, whatever makes you happy. If you're used to that FPS style, you know, go for it.
So, okay, so just to confirm that this game runs on a toaster... the minimum system requirements are Windows 7, 1 gigabyte of RAM, DirectX 10.
I think 1 gigabyte of RAM is also the minimum system requirements for Windows 7.
I want to say it's 2.
It's probably more, honestly. Yeah, actually.
You need DirectX 10, you need 200 megabytes of available space on your hard drive,
200 megabytes. This is ridiculous.
And that's it.
That's hilarious. Well, it's meant to run on a phone, so
it can so your shitty computer will play down well, pretty well.
I need to acquire. Well, hopefully this game gets like a DRM-free humble version or something, so I can put it on Bay's laptop and just play Downwell whenever I feel like it.
Mm. Downwell,
instead of just playing Hearthstone on her laptop.
Mm. I really like this game.
Have you tried playing it on your iPad?
I don't have an iPad anymore.
Oh. Never mind. I don't know if that would make it any easier, but maybe the buttons would be bigger, so harder to fudge.
I don't know. I don't like touch controls.
I played some games that have decent touch controls. Like, I played a game basically like you touch anywhere on the left side of the screen and then move your thumb, like your finger down.
Yeah.
Your character will move down.
Yeah. I just don't like them.
Or like Beat Hazard on iOS has like a dynamic joystick that'll like follow your finger.
Okay.
Which sounds kind of weird, but like basically if your finger comes like off of it by like an entire inch, it'll just follow it and generally do what you want it to do. It actually works really well. You don't have to keep track of where your finger is.
Mm.
You kind of just have it somewhere on there. Works really well, I find.
Okay.
Yeah, people are kind of figuring it out. Like some people have it better than others. This is very simple implementation. You hold the game in portrait mode.
Mm-hmm.
You hold the phone in portrait mode, and it's just like the bottom is just left and right. Like bottom left is left and right, and then there's just a button on the right. And I thought for sure that they would work better than it does, but it's just like I said before. It just doesn't
do it that good.
Yeah, it's just really imprecise. So yeah. It works okay, but still,
like if you just want to play Downwell for like a hot minute, it'll do.
I never got to the second stage. I never got to Catacombs.
Right.
You beat three levels, you get to Catacombs. I never got to Catacombs on the iOS version. And my first try of the PC version, I got there. So.
Yeah. I've gotten to the third stage. I've heard there's at least five. I don't know how many more.
Really? Are. Holy crap.
Yeah.
That's daunting.
So here's the other thing that I do know about this game. You can beat it. There is an end. You can get to the bottom of the well.
So, that sounds really hard.
I think it's very hard, probably. Can I tell you about stage 3 and then you'll get like really mad?
Sure.
Stage 3, it takes place entirely underwater because it's a well.
Okay, let's do it.
The funny thing is that the gravity is the same.
Then what does it matter?
You have an oxygen gauge.
Oh, get out of here! That's amusing. Like I think that's funny.
Yeah.
So if I were to pick out a complaint about this game,
okay,
I would say it's the fact that it just challenges you to get good, and I don't necessarily like games like that. I like games more like something like Crypt of the Necrodancer. If you're gonna have a roguelite, my favorite ones are ones that make you a little bit more powerful in like subsequent runs, or you know, allow you to unlock new items and use those in the future, stuff like that. This is just like you unlock new styles and palettes, but it doesn't actually do anything necessarily.
Yeah, it's like, just I have all the styles unlocked. There's not that many.
And you're not any closer to getting to the bottom of the well than you ever were when you started playing the game, besides the fact that you're just slightly better at it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I that's my main objection to the game, is that that's just like... Some games, like, definitely have that perfect curve where you suck at it and you just get a little bit better, a little bit better, a little bit better, and then you can eventually beat it. Like, the curve matches right up to like time spent playing before you get frustrated to how good you're getting. I don't know if there's five whole levels. I don't know if that's going to line up. I don't know if I'm going to invest the time to like be able to beat Downwell.
Because yeah, I mean,
it seems like a big time commitment just to play it until I'm good enough to beat it.
Yeah, that's definitely the case. It's definitely about you play to be good, and then you get better, and then you get farther, and then you have to be good again to get farther. It's definitely that.
I don't know how much better at Downwell I can get. I'm sure there's room for improvement, but
I mean,
this good now, and I can only get to like the third stage.
Yeah.
Like, how much better can I get that 11? It's just like you have to get like a super lucky run.
I mean, I actually just like playing the game, so I've definitely cooled down on it a little bit.
Yeah, and, I mean, I'm not stressing it. I want to play Downwell. That's fun, and I play it until we have to record a podcast.
Right, and
then I stop.
I don't necessarily feel like I want to beat it either. But I like the way it plays, and when I need to, like, play a game for like 5 minutes, I'm like, oh, okay, cool. I'll play Downwell for 5 minutes.
It does play really well, although sometimes your runs can take longer than 5 minutes. But
yeah,
like I said, I had to pick something bad about it, that's my one complaint. But as of right now, I still think it's fun. It's a great game. It controls really well. Super, super great game.
Yeah,
going to continue to play it.
Good.
Okay. So we talked about a game. We both played. Then whose turn is it?
How many games did you play this week, Nick?
Same number you did.
I'm older than you.
It's a lot of games. So what does that mean? It means you get to go?
Or
is it you just saying that?
I'm just saying that as something to contest about.
Well, ladies first, so yeah, go ahead, Ryan.
Oh, okay.
Sick burn.
Ham. So I played a game.
So we talked about last week. You're like, what game do I play? there's three games I want to play. I'm going to buy one.
There's three games I want to buy. Which one should I buy? And then you're like, okay, you're going to buy Tales of Zestiria. And I'm like, okay. And then I did. And then I also bought another game, too.
Yeah, you said you were going to buy one. Okay, so
I didn't listen to myself.
Tales of Zestiria.
Yep.
Let's talk about how you pre-ordered that game.
I did pre-order that game. Yep, that's true. I pre-ordered it. I stayed up till midnight to play it because I really wanted to play it. I played it for an hour, and then I'm like, uh-oh. I don't know if I like this game.
You're like, uh-oh, I don't know if this game's good.
So I went to bed. I slept on it. I woke up. I went to go play it. I played a little bit harder. And I'm like, I don't know if I like this game. And then I went to work. And I played it again this morning. And I still don't know if I like that game.
So how far are you in? Like, how many hours have you played?
I've only played it for about 3 hours. So, granted.
So you've only played it for 0.5%. The entire game, because it's the Tales of...
I'm definitely out of the tutorial. There's definitely, like, a moment in the game where it's like, okay, you're not in the tutorial, you're out in the world doing stuff. And I'm like, okay, cool, so I'm in the game now. I'm still playing it. I'm like, man, this is just not that fun.
I feel like that's how low-level Tales games play.
Maybe.
And you just have to get further and get more skills and stuff, and then it'll be more fun.
So this game is very, very different from Tales games.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but on the idea of Tales games being boring, I think maybe Tales games have always been boring.
They are.
And we just didn't realize that because we didn't have games like awesome action games like Bayonetta to compare them against.
Boy, is that a thing.
And then just like when you're playing like Tales of Symphonia, you're just like, holy crap, I've never seen a game like this before in the entire world. Like, every time I swing my sword, like, I use a special move. Like, but it's not, like, it's not that exciting.
Oh, dude.
And maybe they just haven't really kept up. Although Tales of Vesperia was okay.
Tales of Vesperia is still good.
I think it's still the best one. Tales of Vesperia or Tales of the Abyss? Probably.
I like Vesperia.
I know you do.
Okay, so here's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
They tried to make almost a Bayonetta style action game.
Uh oh.
They tried.
You can't do it halfway.
They did. They definitely did. You push circle a lot as like your main attack. That's fine. They switch it to circle? It's circle. Yeah, isn't that weird? They made it Japanese.
Can you change it?
You might be able to change it. I haven't.
Maybe it's because the whole confirm, go back, like XO confusion.
I don't know.
But Japanese Tales games have always been circle to attack and X for arts.
Oh, really? That's how it is in this game.
They finally did it. Are all of the skits voiced?
Yes.
10 out of 10, best game ever.
There's also on-disc Japanese audio, if you're into that.
That's a cool thing.
Yeah.
And by on-disc, you mean you're playing the Steam version?
No, I'm playing it on PS4. Not on-disc, but I downloaded it.
Oh, for some reason...
I thought about getting it on Steam, but then I was like, I don't know if this game's going to run as good on a PC, because I never did that before. Anyway.
They were pushing it pretty hard. I think they figured it out.
All right.
I'm just saying.
Well, okay, so... instead of the traditional, like, you're viewing the right side of your character most of the time, like, almost 2D, but then you can free run, like, perspective, it's now behind the back, A.
Mm-mm. I don't like it.
You can still free run. You can still free run. That's okay.
All right, I feel a little better.
But there's a stupid little bar called it's called the SC bar. I don't know what that stands for.
It doesn't mean anything.
It might not mean anything.
It's just evocative.
It's the SC bar. It fills up when you're not doing anything, and it goes down when you're doing stuff. Anything? What do you mean?
Just attacking, or like...
All attacks require use of your SC gauge.
Do arts just use more? Or do you have MP as well?
No, the arts just use more.
Okay.
It's bad. It's really bad.
Isn't that exactly what Tales of Graces did?
Yes. And I never liked it, but I still played that game. I always thought it was bad, but I still played that game. I don't know why. It was a bad game. It's really bad because you're like getting in the action, and then like halfway through an enemy life bar, you have to stop. You have to stop attacking.
What was wrong with the old formula?
I don't know.
You do arts, you get regular attacks.
You get like MP. 3-hit combos that you can do a bunch. You can do as many of those as you want. You can do it until they're dead. Not in this game.
You can still guard and magic, and you can do sidesteps.
They haven't talked about magic guarding, but I bet it's coming.
It'll be there.
I'm so upset.
I'm sorry, Ryan.
I had such high hopes for this game. I'm gonna keep playing it because like I saw some like trailer footage and the combat looks really fluid, and that's my big problem with it, is that it's not fluid right now. Because you have to sit there and stop. So I'm gonna assume at some point there's a bullshit Tales system that comes into play here where you get, like, if you stand in the circle, you get more charge. SC charge. And I'm like, okay, I want that to happen. Please let that happen. I don't know, man.
You should, like, YouTube Tales of Zestiria, like, combo video or something, and some crazy Japanese person use, like, 3 controllers at the same time to do some insane, like, combo video.
Yeah.
Which, some of the other entries have had insane ones that show off the diversity of the battle system in those games.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And maybe it is there just in late-level play, and it's worth sticking with?
I don't know. I'm probably gonna give it another, I want to give it like another like 10 hours, but I like realistically I don't know if I have like want to commit to that, because I just, it's not fun. I'm not having fun.
Yeah.
Which is a huge bummer.
Yeah, that sucks. Because having fun is like...
This is why we play video games, man.
Yeah. I think we may have discussed this at one point. It's just like, if you're not having fun, like...
Don't do it.
What are you doing? Like, why are you playing that game?
So, I don't know. I'm really thinking that Tales of Zestiria is really bad. And the combat is horribly designed.
That's really unfortunate.
Yeah.
Because I guess we should have just... Going into it, we should have prepared ourselves, like... We just don't... Even if that game gets good after 40 hours... Like,
I don't got time for that.
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm saying. Like, we got all these other games to play.
Yeah.
If this game is not good, like, within, like, a little bit, unless it's, like, Metal Gear Solid 5 that gets a pass automatically.
Yeah.
Because it's, like, it's Metal Gear, shut up. Mm. Like, it's different. Like, what are you talking about? It's just different. Like, you don't understand. It's different. But besides that, like, don't necessarily have the time to commit these games where we're trying to play, like, so many different games.
Yeah. Yeah, it's true.
I mean, that's just the sad fact about JRPGs.
Like, Undertale is, like, the perfect RPG of 2015 because if you want to play it a bunch, you can. But if you also want to play it once, you can. You know, so... Man. Like... It's the funny thing is, though, is, like, it's not, like, a time thing because, like, I've put some serious time into Witcher this year. I've put some serious time into Metal Gear this year.
How many hours you play Witcher for? Approximately.
I'll go look at my Steam thing right now. Where is it?
Search for it.
There it is. 32 hours I've put into The Witcher.
How many?
32.
Oh, that seems pretty reasonable.
I mean, I haven't been doing like an ass load of the side stuff. I've done some of it, that whatever's interest me. I probably have another like 10 hours to go, I think. Maybe, from what I've heard. So yeah, it's not exclusively a time thing, but it's like if I don't have fun in like the first couple hours, I don't know if I want to play your game anymore, man. Even if like the rest of it looks kind of good. Like if I don't have any fun.
Yeah. That's what it comes down to,
you know.
Like, yeah, we should have just... Maybe we should have thought about that and just be like, yeah, just get Transformers, because that game will be, like, immediately fun.
Man! That's, like, the big regret I have right now. It's like, I could have like, bought Transformers.
I bet Transformers is the opposite of that. That you'd be like...
I'd be pushing after, like, and 5 minutes,
you'd be like, hell yeah, motherfucker! And just be having a great time, like, immediately.
I fucked up.
And then, like, maybe you'd realize that it doesn't have the depth you want it to, but, like, you would definitely be having fun for, like, a solid, like, 2 hours. Like, the time you spent playing Tales of Zestiria, trying to have fun, you would have had that much fun with Transformers, and then maybe you found out it wasn't as deep or as good as you thought it was, but you would have had fun.
I would have had fun. So,
That's the other game you got, though, out of the three, right?
No.
Oh. That's awkward.
That's awkward.
Oh, that's no good. Can I tell you about a game that is fun? Or are you still going to talk about, like, unfun games?
I don't have any more unfun games to talk about.
So. Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a little teaser for things to come. For fans of the show know what I played Dragon Quest Heroes: The World Trees Woe and The Blight Below.
But it sounds like a horrible title. That's
really bad. I don't know why they went with that. They could have just... Dragon Quest Heroes would have worked. So here's the thing about this game, man.
Okay.
I have fun playing this game. I just wanted to get that, because we're talking about fun. I just wanted to say that straight out.
Nice, okay, fun's good.
This game is, like, super British.
How British is it?
Everyone is British.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why.
It's because they paid one localization team to do it. And they
Word.
Yeah.
I thought so too. But then I was like.
Did you Google it?
I didn't Google it, but that's what my exact thought was.
That happens sometimes.
Like.
With some games, you only get.
Maybe Dragon. So here's what I was thinking. Dragon yeah. Quest is probably bigger in Europe than it is in America.
Sure.
And so Nintendo of America, or not Nintendo of America, but Sony of America, or whatever they call their organization over here, they said, like, hey, we don't want to pay to localize this, but we want to, what if we just distribute it, we could make money.
Right.
Like, it's like, we don't know if we'll make money if we pay to localize it, too, so we'll just borrow the UK's or Europe's version.
Yeah.
And just sell that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
that
mm-hmm.
maybe is what happened, but also, Dragon Quest is apparently just British every time it's localized. Dragon Quest VIII,
really?
Everyone was British.
Really?
I don't Everyone was that. European. I don't like, everyone that. Was like, I mean, like, generally you had a British accent, or maybe you'd have like a Cockney accent, or, you know, like a accent from Wales or Scotland or something.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone was really highly stylized. They all had highly stylized European accents, even so much as, like, so specifically, I guess the characters I'm most familiar with are Jessica and Yangus from 8, even though I never really played 8.
Okay, yep.
First of all, Yangus, like, every other word out of his mouth is core blimey. Like, C-O-R, like, that's like a core blimey, like, that's like a phrase that exists. It's, like, even his text written out is British sounding. It's like has an accent in it.
Oh, that's
and so like I even that. Was that's just good. I looked up just some basic like gameplay videos of Dragon Quest VIII to jog my memory.
Yep.
And they just everybody's a little bit European sounding.
I don't remember
what
that.
Other. I so I guess the only thing I can think of is either we have been doing that for years. We just borrow Europe's translation because it's more popular over there. Like I said before. Or, like, someone decided a long time ago that because Dragon Quest is a fantasy setting, that means it has to be British, which is, like, my number one least favorite trope of all time.
Yeah, that sucks.
Dragon's Age kind of gets a pass because apparently the British people in that game, like, there's British people and French people, but they're not called that, and they're just so directly related. Like, they're just adaptations of the real countries in interesting
right.
ways that I'm like,
right.
all right, you guys. But it's like, and then like, but like Fable is the one that bothers me the most. And the reason that is British is because it's made by British people. They got British voice actors to do it. But like, that's the quintessential game that is British for no reason. It's also why I like Skyrim so much as a setting.
Is it because they don't,
they are not all British.
Yeah, that's good stuff.
And I feel like there are plenty of production companies in this world that would have made that game and just made everyone British.
Mm.
Or, like, tried really hard to give everybody accents.
Right.
Like, oh, well, if you're a Breton, you speak like this. All Bretons have an accent. Like, it's like, no, people are just people. And, like, Khajiits talk funny because they're cats. But sure. Besides that, what are some other... Name another Dragon Quest game that had voice acting. What was Dragon Quest IX? What even was that game?
Was that the MMO?
No, that was the DS one. I thought that was 10.
That is the DS one.
What's Dragon Quest 10?
That's the MMO.
What's Dragon Quest 7?
That might have been on PS1. It was, yeah.
Apparently, so another thing I found is that apparently in Japan they announced Dragon Quest 8 3D.
Wasn't that game already in 3D?
No, it's like for 3DS.
Oh, really? Weird.
Also, I think... Oh, they're bringing Dragon Quest VII to 3DS as well. Did you hear about Dragon Quest XI?
No. What is that?
It's for PS4 and 3DS.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. No, you heard me. You heard me right.
Are you sure?
Yes. Because the PS... So the 3DS, the top screen is going to be like a 3D modeled game.
Okay.
Like, it'll look on the PS4.
Yep.
Kind of, it looked a little bit reminiscent of, like, those Final Fantasy remakes.
Gross. Okay.
But maybe not as shitty. Bottom screen, straight up, like, NES Dragon Quest, like, with a grid and everything.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's pretty cool.
That's, like, really just a cool enough idea that just, like, I don't like Dragon Quest, and I kind of want that game.
Yeah.
So I'm trying to find a localization of Dragon Quest VII. I don't know if that really exists.
That might not exist, or at least not voice acting, because that was on PS1, and I don't think they did that on PS1 very much.
Oh, I could look at Dragon Quest Swords, which is like a Was that developed by... I don't know. That always seemed like a crappy Dynasty Warriors ripoff, too.
I don't fucking know.
Man, this is good podcasting, is all I'm saying.
Because we don't know shit.
Dragon Warrior 7. No, that's the Japanese one, because it's Dragon Warrior. Dragon Quest. Either way. Dragon Quest Heroes : The World Tree's Woe and the Blight Below is very British. It's insanely British. And even so much as in the text, not just in the speech, but like defense is spelled with a C at the end.
Gross.
Which is British. There's armor. There's just like all those armor.
Oh, dude. Fucking Final Fantasy Tactics Advanced. No. On the DS. Actually, probably both.
A2? Yeah, what about
them? Yeah. It's the same thing for that. Because, like, magic was spelled weird, and all the armors and colors and stuff was all spelled weird.
What is it, really?
Yeah.
But was that a localization thing?
It must have been.
Well, I should have done my research about how this got localized, because I bet that information exists somewhere. I fucked up. I know. I'm sorry.
Fucked up.
But I wasn't concerned with that, because I was just having a fun time playing that game.
Well, that's good.
So, I like... You have your main character, and the combat system hasn't really evolved like I had wanted it to. But whenever I get bored of playing as a character, I just switch to someone else. And I just, like, mix up which special skill I use. Because you get, like, a choice of a bunch of different spells by holding R1 and pressing a face button. You gotta do different combos, and, like, you can level up. You get, like, skill trees, and you can say, like, oh, hey, make it so that this particular combo, when I hold triangle, you'll charge up for a second before you attack.
Mm-hmm.
That's like that's like a little bit, but ultimately, like, you have four characters in the battle, so you're just like, oh, I'm bored of this character's combos. I'll just switch to a different one.
I wish you could do that in One Piece Musou.
That'd be cool.
Yep.
In Dynasty Warriors, no, sorry, Samurai Warriors 4, you get two at a time, and you can make the other one go do, like, you'd be like, hey, go attack that guy, and when he gets there, you can switch to him and then attack that guy.
That sounds great.
It's brilliant, dude. Mm-hmm. And they recently released Samurai Warriors 4 2, which adds, like, a new character.
Excuse me?
It's like Final Fantasy X-2, but not like that at all.
Fuck that shit.
Yeah, I don't even know what makes it unique. I don't. Even I am, like, I'm all set.
Okay.
But this really isn't a Dynasty Warriors game. Like, it's an action game with RPG stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a fun action game. The boss battles can be a little bit annoying sometimes, because it's just, you feel like you're tooling on a guy, and then he tries to hit you back. But you also, like, roll out of the way and guard and stuff. It feels way more dynamic than any other Dynasty Warrior game I've played.
Mm-hmm.
Because Dynasty Warriors games have always been about, like, just juggling the crap out of bad guys, as far as I'm concerned. This is like, oh, this guy's really big, I'm going to hit him and then dodge out of the way. And sometimes that's really annoying, but sometimes, like, you'll be like an ogre and you're hitting him and he goes to swing and you dodge. You're just like, yeah, that felt pretty good. It's obviously not Bayonetta level.
Right.
Because nothing is Bayonetta level. It's not even quite God of War level. Actually, it might be, but God of War level. God of War is really basic. And it's fun. I'm having fun playing it. That being said, I don't care about the story.
Yeah.
One time I was just, like, skipping cutscenes, and it skipped from one cutscene to another cutscene, and then I think someone died in the cutscene that I skipped.
Oh, shit.
Because everyone was sad, and then, like, some guy was, like, one of the guys wasn't there anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, does that guy die? And I was like, I don't even care. Like, he wasn't, I didn't use him, in my party, so, like, I'm glad he's dead. Yeah, it's interesting. They have that cast of characters from other Dynasty Warriors games.
Mm-hmm.
From other Dragon Quest games. And that's kind of cool. Fans of the series. And, like, there's just some kind of self-referential funny little things that I don't even, as a fan of the series, I wouldn't think I would get.
Mm-hmm.
But some things I'm like, okay, I can kind of see, I get that. Like, this one character, he has, I guess one of the spells he cast in the game was a skill called Thwack.
Okay.
Because if you remember anything about playing Dragon Quest Monsters, all the abilities had silly names.
That's true, I do remember that.
Speaking of which, this game looks good. and all the monsters that you've seen, like, pictures of, like, 2D mm-hmm. pictures of, when they mm-hmm. render them in 3D, they look just like that monster. Like, they look good. And so this guy would use a skill called Thwack that had, like, a percentage chance of automatically killing the monster, a monster.
Yep.
Like, Modoon or whatever, or Hama in Persona.
Oh, okay, sure.
And so his, like, he goes in, like, tension mode or whatever, and he tension mode, you're, like, you do more damage, you get a limited 8 MP, and you can't take any damage. And then if you press circle again, you'll do, like, a big move. You'll do, like, a super muso. And his is him, like, trying to cast Thwack repeatedly and just says Thwack failed. And it's, like, a montage of him casting it, like, tens of dozens of times. Mm-hmm, and then eventually mm-hmm. he just, you know, does some super Thwack thing. It's, like, you know, kind of goes on a little bit too long the second or third time. But, it, you know, what's the first time? I was like, yeah, I get it. He's frustrated like we are that Thwack doesn't work. It's probably a bullshit skill that's garbage. Because it kills people. I got it. Like, I played, like, RPGs before. Like, I get that. It's just, like, so funny. Like, there's a lot of charming stuff in this game, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Fans of the series will definitely appreciate this game. And they'll... Hopefully, they would also appreciate, like, the new dynamic elements that are added to the game. It's not just turn-based, press X, select skill. Yeah. Which is good, but... This feels like an evolution of a Dragon Quest game more than, like, just a branded Dynasty Warriors game.
Mm. Well, that's kind of cool.
That's really cool. Like, yeah. I'm impressed that they were able to do that. Because it's really easy just to make it seem like, you know, like, One Piece Musou, as much as I love it, is
It's about that. Playing as One Piece.
Dude. It's, yeah. I mean, you get to play as One Piece dudes. That's a cool part, but ultimately, it's just... This is a Dynasty Warriors game. We put One Piece in it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like that? And you're like, yeah, I do.
yeah.
But if you don't like Dynasty Warriors, you're not going to like that game. I think even people who don't like Dynasty Warriors games might get enjoyment out of this game,
mm-hmm.
especially if they're Dragon Quest fans. This is just something I want to mention. I don't want to bring up everything I don't like about the game, but, like, your party, like, attacks independent of you, or yep. they kind of follow you around. They'll attack kind of what you're attacking. Those guys need to attack more. Because I'll just be wailing on a dude, and they're just like... They'll attack, like, twice, and then just, like, stop. They'll be chilling.
Mm.
Although they're pretty good at casting the proper support skills.
Mm-hmm.
So it's cool. Like, that guy who casts Thwack, he's got, like, a defense buff, so I keep him around. And then Jessica, she's got, like, a healing... She's got Cha-Cha Dance, where she just summons maracas out of nowhere and she that are shaped like slimes, and she dances, and sure. that heals the party.
Okay.
The gameplay, like, the maps themselves could use, like, a little bit more variety.
Mm-hmm.
It's, like, a lot of the time it's defend this position, or monsters are going to be summoning in different parts of the map. It's still very much, like, a stationary map. Like, mm-hmm. you're not moving from... Well... Played a map last night that had, like, teleporters to different floors in it, and you kind of had to move to different places to get on different teleporters to get to other teleporters to get back to, like, the upper level of the first room.
Mm-hmm.
They do
mm-hmm.
a little bit of that stuff, but, like, for the most part, it's just a big static area like a Dynasty Warriors game is. There's no, like, dynamic moving through the dungeon.
Yeah.
So they could use a little bit more variety there, but in short bursts, like, it's really fun to just pick up and kind of have at it. And you buy some items, and you do some quests. There's a bunch of replayable stuff, just like you can go back in and beat up monsters if you feel like it.
Mm-hmm.
But it doesn't mm-hmm. seem, unless there's, like, some big crazy plot twist coming where they open up, like, a second map, doesn't seem like it's a super long game, which I'm fine with.
Yeah. Sick. Okay.
But, I mean, if you want to play more, you want to grind, you can definitely do that, but if you don't, you just play right through. And, you know, I don't know if I mentioned this on the podcast or not, but I remember I saw a YouTube review, and someone, one of the biggest critique they had of the game is that it was just too easy.
Mm-hmm.
It is very easy, and that you can't change the difficulty.
Yeah.
But it's not that easy. Like, if you're not careful with some of the boss fights, like, some of those monsters, like, some of those bear guys can, like, take out half your life in one swing.
Yeah.
It's not as easy as this guy made it out to be, but it's not hard either. So
that guy only likes really hard, like,
hardcore. Yeah, that guy's just games. Like, yeah, I only play Dark Souls, a really hardcore game for hardcore gamers such as me. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I think it's good. I'd recommend it.
That's just great.
If it's ever, like, there will be a time 6 to 12 months from now that the PSN is like, hey, Japanese game sale, or RPG game sale, and it'll be like $36, and it'd be pretty good. I paid full price, and I don't, like, regret it, but getting it for even less, even different.
Even different.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you probably already know if you're going to like this game. So if you know you're going to like this game,
go buy it.
Do it. Download it. It's like 28 gigs.
Shit, really?
I think it's more like 22. Fine. So it'll only take PSN like 4 hours to download it.
Truth.
Sick burn. Right, do we have enough time to speak about the other games we played, or should we save that shit?
I wanna save my other one, because I wanna play it a tiny bit more before I really get into it.
Okay,
so that works for me.
I'm gonna mention. Do I want to talk about Cradle?
No.
Because I actually don't want to say anything really about Cradle. I want to keep it short.
Okay, so just.
And maybe if I play it more, there'll be something, I think of something else to say about it.
That's fine.
So real quick, guys, Cradle. It's a sci-fi 3D first-person adventure game on Steam. And it is, I mean, if any of those words excited you in the least amount, well, I mean, if you're just first person, I like those kinds of games. Is, you know, that's not necessarily indicative that you're going to like this game. But, like, the thing that this game does is it establishes a super unique premise, like, piece by piece. It's a little bit tropey in the whole, like, you have amnesia thing. Mm-hmm. So you learn elements about the world. This world is, like, it does that really cool sci-fi thing where the world of the game or the world of the fiction is just like a couple degrees off of our world.
Right.
So there's like elements you relate with and understand. And then like they introduce this element that defies what you know from real life. And you're like,
sure,
that's cool. The best example I could think of off the top of my head is Custom Robo for the GameCube.
The best game on the GameCube.
I liked that game.
It's a great game.
And at one point, they're just like, yeah, everyone knows the world is flat. And you're just like, what the fuck are you talking about? The world is round. And you're just like, what are you, stupid? The world's flat. Everyone knows that. And when you go to the end of the world, there's a wall there, and you can't go anymore. And you're just like, what? And it's like this big like plot device. And it's like, blew my mind when I was a kid. So it's... That's kind of exaggerated example of that. But this is just like, you learn all these details, you read a bunch of newspaper articles and things that are like totally optional, or you can kind of just advance the game and have it spell it out for you. And it's like an adventure game, you have a little inventory, but it's not like one of those like old school adventure games where you're carrying like a fish through the entire game, trying to use it on everything, thinking like, it's got to be used for this fish. Because every time you start the game, it works in chapters. So the game is like 24 chapters. Mm-hmm. And when you restart the game, or when you like turn the game back on and you hit resume, it just loads you into the beginning of the most recent chapter. A little bit frustrating if you don't have, like, you have to stop in the middle of a session. But if you're making good progress, it's not too bad. And so, but every time you load it back in, your inventory is wiped. Which says to me, like, in every scenario, every chapter, they give you what you need. Which I'm fascinated by.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, it's really cool. If you like sci-fi, it's a really interesting... So far, the story is kind of reminiscent of some stories that are being told in like other games in fiction right now. That's what I said. I stand by it. Like, I want to say that I haven't played Soma yet, but...
You play Soma, so you can tell me if it's good.
I have already heard that it's very good.
I've heard that too.
But I'm too afraid to play it. There, I said it. No, I need to find the right time to play it, and that just hasn't come up yet. Fair. But I think, like, this game, Cradle, and Soma touch upon some of the same elements of, like, that science fiction stuff. Like, it's all stuff, it's all stories that's kind of been told before, but it's nothing quite like I've seen before, although I don't really ingest a lot of science fiction. But it's like $12 on Steam. I don't want to talk about the story of it too much because it's something that I think it's really fun to discover the pieces of by yourself and kind of just go like, oh, so that's what's happening here. And if you like adventure games at all, like science fiction, it's not like one of those games you should probably just go for it. That's one of the other games that I just bought because I heard about it before and I saw some videos. And I was like, this game looks pretty cool. Like, first of all, the game looks good. And I was like, this game looks cool. And I kind of just, like, put it on my wish list, and I was like, I'll get it when it goes on sale. And then I was like, I should just buy it, because I'm going to eventually. Same thing with Undertale.
Undertale's good shit.
I own Undertale now, because I was like, there's a 0% chance I'm not going to play this game at some point.
You better fucking play that game real soon.
I am going to play that game. I just need to, like...
I'm going to remind you, like, every week to play Undertale.
Please do.
Okay, I will.
Because I need to... No. I will get to it eventually.
That game's fucking great.
A lot of other stuff to do. Hey, so let's talk about things that happened in the world of video games.
Oh, shit. All right.
So
Atari's back with a new console. It's called the 3850.
Atari 2015.
Atari... 10/21/2015 Back to the Future Edition.
The Atari 42911. Nailed it.
That's the one. That's the good one.
All right. So we're gonna save that one for last. So the Steam. So Steam stuff. The Steam hardware stuff. Do you have any?
I got me one of them controllers.
Oh really?
Yep.
What you think? How do you feel? How you feeling it's right now?
Really bad.
Whoa!
It's really bad.
Oh, I was not ready for that. I said, what, you haven't mentioned it to me?
Yeah, it's really bad. Anyway, so friend of the show, Joe, he got one and he's like, yeah, my dongle broke in like 3 minutes, and then and then I'm like, yeah.
Can't do nothing with a broken dongle. I always say
bad controller.
What did you play with it?
I turned on Downwell and I'm like, okay, this is just a Xbox 360 style gamepad in a certain extent. So I tried that. My hand cramped up like immediately.
What kind of game you were playing it with?
I was playing Downwell.
Oh. I don't think you should. So, my understanding of how that what that controller is made for and how it works is it's made to be a mouse and keyboard, or it's made to be a mouse.
So I did a little bit of that. So I tried to play some City Skylines because that's the game that everybody talks about when they're like, "Oh yeah, I know the Steam controller. I'm gonna try it out with City Skylines. That sounds sick. I can play it from my couch." It's trash. I can't do it. It's like, it's
maybe
too
you're just bad.
It's too nonspecific, and it's like you're. I try to like move it gently, and then the cursor's just like all over the place. The right thumb pad has some really awful tactile feedback stuff that I just hate. It like vibrates. I just hate it. It vibrates like kind of like an old school iPod. Wheel. Uh-oh. Did it's really bad, and the triggers are like super shallow, so that sucks. So buttons are really small, and that sucks.
The one thing, because it was coming out, like, it's out for people who pre-ordered it. I heard that you could now pre-order these things on Amazon now. So, like,
yeah, I think so.
November, sometime in November is their, like, official release date.
Yeah.
But the one kind of anecdote I picked up about it through Twitter, I follow Tom Francis. He made Gunpoint, and he used to work for PC Gamer.
Mm-hmm.
And he's really—he played a lot of Metal Gear Solid 5. Seemed to like it a lot. I don't know. I just another anecdote about Tom Francis.
Okay.
And he said he's working on a new game, whose name escapes me at the moment. But he said that he found it very remarkable. He was playing the game that he was in the middle of making with the Steam controller, and it's a game that's made for mouse and keyboard, and it just worked. With his game that he was in the middle of making, that he had not added any sort of controller support to. He just pick up the Steam controller and just play it with it.
Oh, it's
really, I think that is a neat thing happening. Really, I need to try this out.
Okay.
Because
if you like it, please take it away from me. I don't want it.
I know, you're hilarious, Ryan. Like, I don't know. You could just own it and not like it.
I don't know. It's like, I bought it because I'm like, oh, okay, I play games from my PC on a couch with relative frequency.
You should just get better at using it, because that controller exists for you.
I know it does.
You're one of the few that can get real use out of that controller. Please just use it until you like it.
I don't think I have to do that.
Just, I'm asking you to. Cause
this is why I have two computers. So I can do both.
Okay, whatever makes you happy, Ryan.
Nothing makes me happy.
So what about the so the Steam Link is like another thing that Kate has been coming out with the controllers.
Boy, I want one of those to work, but I feel like home networks are just not up to snuff for that shit yet.
I've heard they might work.
No way.
Like, I haven't heard. I've actually been looking for people who've been officially reporting whether these things work. I don't think that is happening yet.
Mm-hmm.
People are like reviewing the products. I want to say CNET is putting up something about them. Maybe it's up already. Clearly, this is how much I care about the issue that I've already looked. But I've heard kind of the random people on Twitter and things like that they're not trash, which is so exciting to me because I want one of these so bad. Because I've got a computer that is near my TV, but I still need it to be my computer. But I would love to just be like, I feel like sitting on my couch while I play Downwell, so boop. And then just play Downwell on my computer. Or take like a PC game for two people that, you know, instead of helping people in front of my desk, just shoot that over the TV and play it.
Yep.
Two Xbox 360 controllers. Couch is still close enough to my desk that the dongle won't have any problem like working. Like, that'd be super sick. But I just need to see if it works. I almost pre-ordered it too, but I was just so concerned that it wouldn't work.
Well, I think Vinny Caravella ordered one.
Yeah, but so he doesn't play video games because he has children.
That's true.
Just putting that out there. But yeah, I swear that CNET's released this thing about whether or not that crap works. So when they do that, I might buy one, because if they work, like, that's a literal dream come true. A crazy, crazy pipe dream that I never thought would happen.
Yeah.
That is going to come true if those things work. So, and it's like $60 for a Steam Link. I definitely don't want to invest in a Steam box.
Oh, I don't. Those are going to be garbage.
Because, like, no. And also, I only want to have, like, games on one PC. I don't want to do some flim-flammy Steam Cloud crap that only works for certain games and doesn't know, like, no, screw that.
Yeah.
PC games live on one computer. Sometimes I'll shoot them over my TV. That'd be heavenly.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll see. We'll see how that works out. But it's officially not out until November. It's just the pre-orders came out recently.
Yeah, I have one. I pre-ordered it because I'm an idiot.
Well, No, you're an innovator. You went for it.
I went for it. I want to like just it, like but Tales it makes of my hand feel like Zestiria. Garbage.
I really didn't, like, I did not care about ever using this controller until you told me about how much you hated it, and now I just need, I need to feel it. Like, I need to see.
It makes you feel better. Joe hates it too, so.
Oh, he seemed excited when he texted me about it.
Joe was more amped about it than I was.
And yeah, he seems really into it. Probably after about 3 minutes and his dongle broke, he's probably just like, all right, now this seems kind of fucked up.
Thing. Yeah. So, anyway, that's that.
Okay, so Harmonix news.
All right, Harmonix news corner featuring Ryan. We got
two Harmonix and newsmakers.
Less exciting thing. So there's like an official post about Harmonix on disc Rock Band stuff coming to Rock Band 4. There's a big old fancy chart.
Another chart.
There's a chart. So so basically the core of the chart is if you have not exported Rock Band and Rock Band 2 songs to Rock Band 3, you're fucked.
Crap. That's
bottom line.
Wait, can I do it now?
No.
Shit.
Did you not do that?
I don't think one is in there. Well, I didn't know you could do one.
Did you ever do 1 to 2?
No, because I didn't own 2 on 360.
Oh, yeah, you're fucked.
So I bought 3 on 360, and I had a copy of 2 from the guy I bought all of my instruments from, and I put 2 into 3. I can never have 1 in 4 now?
No.
Fuck Harmonix.
Yeah. I mean, realistically, it's like they had a time deal on track export stuff, and then once it went up, it's all over.
Oh, this is garbage. I don't want to... Yep. I'm never buying Rock Band 4.
That's it. He's done.
I don't see... I'd rather buy, like, instead of buying... No. No, Ryan. No.
No, Ryan, no.
Ryan,
no. So it gets even weirder.
It's just good to know that I'm free now.
So if you bought Rock Band 3 used, you might be fucked.
Because you still need that code in the back or something?
I'm trying to find the specific language that they use so I don't fuck this up.
Let me ask you something while you read that.
Yep.
Is there any reason, if the Xbox One can recognize Xbox 360 discs?
Yep.
Because they do the whole backwards compatible thing where you put the disc in and it says, oh, hey, this is that game. We're going to download a executable version of it on your Xbox One, and then you can play it.
Yep.
Why can't I just put in the 3 version of... Why can't I put 3 to my Xbox One? It goes, hey, you own Rock Band 3. Give us $8.50 and you can download all the tracks.
Okay, the export price is going to be $15.
That is a lot of songs for $15.
But
just put that on my tab, Ryan.
So the export offer will only be extended to those who are verified purchasers of Rock Band 3, meaning that Harmonix will need to verify your purchase electronically using data from your online profile. In the post, Harmonix says that the export offer will only work for those who, quote, bought a new copy and played Rock Band 3.
I don't think I even qualify for that.
I
don't remember if I qualify for that.
I qualify for that.
I don't know if I bought a new one that was cheap or if I got a, like, Amazon certified used pre-owned Mazda. Like, I don't even know.
I don't know. So that's a big fucking mess.
I'm like really pissed at Harmonix right now.
Yeah. So other things that are not available to export anymore. Green Day Rock Band.
Good.
You have that. The Beatles Rock Band was never available to export. So, nope.
Which, fuck that. That makes sense.
All the track packs that they've put out
All the discs?
Yeah. Those are all still available to export.
Cool.
Apparently, if you own Rock Band Blitz, all of those songs are currently available to export for no money.
Yeah, those are all DLC songs, I'm pretty sure, that you got for free if you own Blitz.
Okay. So that's that.
That's good to know, though. That's dope.
Yeah. Should I talk about the other?
Is this one less heartbreaking?
A little bit.
Like, they're just like $15. What about two and one? Are those $15 too?
So those will come over because you already paid for them.
Those will come over, like, as part of three?
They don't know how to do that yet.
Okay, stop talking about it now.
Okay.
I'm getting mad. Because this is just, I'm looking at, like, the tab of, like, I'm thinking of, like, the old-time diner bill, like, written in waitress pen handwriting of, like, the how much money I have to freaking spend to enjoy playing Rock Band 4, and it's just, it's not worth it.
So, anyway, earlier this week, I sent a tweet to Mad Cat's Rock Band and Harmonix. And I said, why is there no way to buy a second guitar without buying a bundle with a $60 game that I already have? Okay.
And I said, go fuck yourself, Ryan.
And then I got a tweet from Mad Cat today that said standalone instruments will be available early 2016. So
they tweeted directly at you?
Yep.
Oh, shit. Breaking news. We're the best.
We're the best. Bringing you the news. So that's from Mad Cat's. So early 2016, you can buy standalone instruments. I guess.
If you want to spend more money on this godforsaken game.
Yeah.
Dude. Ugh. Sorry, I'm like really upset right now.
That's okay.
All right, dog.
What do you got for me, Holmes?
Real quick.
Okay.
Not quick.
Oh.
YouTube Red.
Oh, this sounds like garbage.
So, for a while, people have been kind of talking, and there have been rumors flying around about YouTube potentially releasing a subscription, like a premium service to people who want to pay a monthly fee to use it.
I don't.
Well, maybe after I tell you what's included in your $10 a month, unless you sign up via Apple's App Store, then it'll cost $13 per month.
What?
I don't know, dude. This is directly from Erin Griffith, bless your heart. She posted this article not but 5 hours ago. She works for Time Magazine Online.com / e-magazine / vaping. And she's great. She posted this article about YouTube Red, and it's very informative. I'm going to tell you about some of the things that she wrote so that we can all understand and discuss better what the fuck YouTube Red is. So, for $9.99 a month, you just have to get some pretty good shit, right?
Yeah, that's a lot of that's a lot of money for...
It's not that much money. So, did you hear that Netflix is raising their price?
I did, yeah.
What are they raising it to?
I think it's $10 instead of $8.
Oh, well, time to just light that on fire and whatever. Nobody pays for Netflix. One person pays for Netflix, and then everyone uses it.
Yeah, that's true.
And they don't even care. So, yeah, that's true. For $9.99 a month, you get three primary features here. You get videos without ads.
Yeah, I have this thing called ad blocker.
But what if you're watching on your console?
I don't.
But what if you were?
I don't, because I have a computer hooked up to my basement television.
That's true.
That is Adblock installed.
But sometimes you have to...
Nope.
What if you wanted to support the content creators that you like on YouTube?
I'd rather subscribe to one of their fucking Patreons or something.
What if they don't have that?
Well, then fuck them. They're not big enough or important enough.
You have to be important to have a Patreon?
No.
So that's something that you get for $10. You also will get the ability to save videos to watch offline.
Why?
Because you wanna.
But Nick, I have like 100 connected devices that I can watch YouTube videos on.
But maybe your internet will not work for a second, and you'll
never watch your video. And then I have to remember to save a video offline.
Yeah, because everyone knows that once you've watched a video on YouTube once, you're just like, oh, I gotta make sure I keep that around for second viewing. You're like, no, that video is dead to me now. I've seen it, and it's gone. Yep. Unless it's like some hilarious like 15-second like video of some guy hurting himself that you're gonna want to show your friends later. But like,
yeah,
whatever. Like, where are you not gonna be able to get that? Like, just on your phone.
Yeah.
Number three. This is the big one.
Okay.
Are you ready for this feature?
Am I gonna get mad?
I don't know. This is like a feature that is just like, why doesn't this feature exist? This is what everyone wants this feature to exist, and this is why, because they're gonna charge you money. The ability to play audio from videos in the background on mobile while using other apps or putting the phone to sleep.
Shut the fuck up.
Did you get mad,
you're
right?
You're joking.
I'm not. I'm as serious as Aaron Griffith was at 5:49 p.m. when she posted this story on time.com/vapelords.
You're joking.
I'm not joking.
Oh, my dear Lord.
What is your problem?
That is a fucking baseline feature that should be included in your goddamn app.
It's a video app. Me? Why would you be able to listen to the video play while you're not, while the video is minimized?
Do you know how many people listen to music on YouTube?
A shitload. Hold on. There was a thing in here about YouTube, and they're working on their... YouTube has been promising a dedicated music app for many months. Today, the company announced that that app, called YouTube Music, is YouTube's third vertical app, allowing a dedicated gaming app and a dedicated... following a dedicated gaming app and a dedicated kids app. YouTube Music will be available soon, the company said.
No.
So, I don't know exactly what that is, if it's going to be like Spotify. I'm not sure. Yeah, but lots of people. I mean, I've got a personal playlist of music on YouTube that I just call music, and like sometimes I listen to it.
No, this is such big garbage.
Like I said, this is the feature that just like, why aren't you mother liggers putting this in here? And it's because they're going to charge you for it. That's why they're not putting that feature in there. It's like, why can't we just have the free map packs? Because we're going to charge you for the map packs, you dumb idiots.
I'm upset.
Okay. It's not over yet.
It's not over yet?
In addition to these features, YouTube Red will include, as expected, original content funded by YouTube. This is the service's second try at financing original content. The first time around, a $100 million initiative in 2011 fizzled, in part because YouTube invested in mainstream stars rather than its own homegrown stars that already had big followings on the platform. So that seems to be, you know, that included a bunch of Aaron Griffith's lovely editorial writing. But
right.
Long story short, it seems like the only content that you'll now be able to get are, like, YouTube original series. YouTube will include, as expected, original content funded by YouTube. So, there were rumors before about potential of, let's say, PewDiePie, whose face is on this article, mm-hmm. and whose lovely girlfriend we were discussing about how That's she true. Should have a very happy birthday today.
Mm-hmm.
People were figuring that as part of this subscription service, PewDiePie would be able to say, like, hey, here's this video. You guys want to watch it? Well, you can't unless you're a YouTube Red subscriber, so kill yourself. Like, that doesn't seem to be what's happening, which is a very good thing. Because when you start letting the people who are making the content be in control of, like, mm-hmm. gating it, everyone's got a whole different idea of what that means to them. And, like, channels are so different. You know, gaming channels and grocery haul channels and, you know, vlogs and, like, all these different channels have such different content patterns and like what is important to them and what people might actually pay to see.
Right.
That there's no way that that would work. To say like you have to subscribe to this catch-all service called YouTube Red for $10 a month and you can watch these particular videos. And then like having the creator like find their like unless YouTube somehow enforces a like strict guideline of like you'd only have this many paid videos versus free video, like there's no way it would work.
This is really bad.
So by saying like the only thing you can watch, you know, like having a Netflix subscription lets you watch like
Orange is New
Black, Hemlock Grove, and, Orange is yeah. New Black, Black Mirror. Is that a Netflix original series?
I'm not sure.
Heard it's good. That kind of stuff, like that's why you get BoJack Horseman.
Yeah.
That would be like so. It's I guess you'd be getting YouTube original content, which may or may not be garbage. You may or may not be able to find on like Daily Motion.
This is all going down after a really terrible.
After someone terrible. Saves their video to watch offline and then uploads it to Vimeo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. Like,
sounds terrible.
Right now, I don't want to do it.
I'm not paying for YouTube ever.
Well,
not gonna do it.
Well, hold on, man.
If you have a Google account, you are now paying for YouTube Red. Please enjoy your awesomely curated YouTube content.
Yep. Basic. No, that's not what's happening here at all.
All right. Good.
So it says here that though they've been working with content creators to make this original, like some of their more popular, like they said, their homegrown content creators. Collaborators include Joey Graceffa, the Fine Brothers, Rooster Teeth, and PewDiePie. The videos will be available exclusively for subscribers, but may be released for the public later, YouTube executives said.
Mm-hmm.
YouTube Red marks an evolution in our desire to give fans more choice and features that they love, said Robert Kinsel, YouTube's chief business officer. So, I don't know, man.
I'm upset.
I guess... Yeah, I don't know. I doubt that there'll ever be a video so great that I'll feel the need to subscribe to be able to watch it. Like, that's just madness, but...
I won't.
Yeah, I know. But you're also not quite as big into YouTube as I am.
That's true.
I can see a bleak future in which I pay $10 a month for this service. Because I also do watch a lot of YouTube on my consoles.
But, Nick, you already pay, like, $15 a month to watch wrestling.
I think it's only $10.
Still too much.
Yeah, but considering how much those pay-per-views cost...
I guess.
Like, if I wanted to just pay for Hell in the Cell this Sunday night, then... That would cost me like $60, which is 6 months of WWE Network.
I mean, you'd be
stupid not to get it.
Yeah.
This is not the first time. That's not even the first time I've said that exact same thing on this podcast, so I need to stop.
You'd be stupid not to get it.
Yeah, man. Oh, here's a good thing at the end. I'm so glad that the lovely Erin Griffith decided to include this in her article. It says... so she writes, when asked about the name YouTube Red, which sounds similar to RedTube, a porn site,
great.
Glotzbach and said names are part art and science. We're not too worried about the other site you mentioned, he said. Because, I'll be honest with you, like, I don't use that website. I don't go to RedTube ever. Mm-hmm. But I saw it was called YouTube Red, and I was like, wait, what? What about RedTube? Oh, no. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I definitely did a double take when I saw that today, too.
I get it. Like, YouTube, its symbol is red and stuff. So, maybe that's why they made it the color of the game. Like, I don't know, man.
Yeah.
I don't... Because, I have so many thoughts and feelings on this, I don't even know what to say. Even if the content is just being created by YouTube with these creators, like, where is the line drawn? And, like, at what point does, like, PewDiePie stop making videos because he has to travel to Los Angeles to work with YouTube to do this, to make content that costs $10 a month? Mm-hmm. And then he doesn't make videos for his channel anymore. And you're like, this is gonna be.
I'm sure to bet this comes with like a massive restructuring of YouTube ad payout, and like,
oh, that like really encourages people to work with YouTube to make content.
That and then
that they also can charge for.
Wait for like all of the videos from like big YouTube people just being like, so I don't get paid as much money anymore. If you want to keep making stuff, subscribe to YouTube Red, please.
I do wonder. I can only assume that, like, if you're part of a YouTube Red video, you just make a certain amount of, like, YouTube's like, here's this much amount of money, and then we're going to use this video that you created with us to promote our service, hopefully get more people to subscribe. But I still think that 100% of those $10 are going directly into Google's pocket, and then they're going to decide what to do with it after that.
Yeah, probably.
Like, I don't think it's going to be some weird Twitch thing where, like, people are making part of the money. But maybe I'm just totally wrong. But that's what it seems like to me, is it's like the creators themselves have very little control. They really have very little influence on YouTube Red, unless they're part of the videos that you can buy as part of it.
Right.
I don't know. This is gonna it's gonna be a freaking thing.
Well, I'm thoroughly depressed.
News is kind of a bummer.
Yeah.
I thought at least we could get happy about new Steam hardware, but no.
No. News is a big bummer this week.
Oh, we didn't even talk about, I didn't even put that in there. I talked about it. So this is a laugh. Okay. Here, we're gonna end this one with a laugh.
Okay.
So you know how Hideo Kojima, like, doesn't work at
Konami
anymore?
Right.
So, supposedly, he officially left Konami.
He's gonna leave in January. That was, like, the tweet I saw.
Well, I guess, I thought he was already gone. But,
I mean, he checked out. Like, he ain't paying attention anymore.
Yeah, he doesn't care. But, yeah. Basically, like, reports were filed that said, like, all right, Kojima, he packed up, he put all the stuff on his desk, he took his life-size Solid Snake, and then he carried it out of the building, and he was gone. He's done.
Yeah.
That was the report. This was published in the New Yorker. Oh, no, hold on. It's originally published in the New Yorker, that said, yeah, he's gone now.
Mm-hmm.
And then Konami, not too long after that, refuted the claim, saying that he just went on vacation. That he's still. Currently, Kojima and the development team are finished development of Guitar Hero Solid 5 and are taking. Currently, Kojima and the development team are finished developing Metal Gear Solid V, and I believe that's how you pronounce that, and are taking a long time off from work. And so the author of the New Yorker article, Simon Parkin, he tweeted a photo, said, here's a photograph of Kojima's farewell party on October 9th at Konami, which Konami claims no knowledge of.
That's great.
And it's like a bunch of them just standing around, and they all have like white cups in their hands, and they're just like, bye, Kojima-san. And hold on. When asked about the farewell party, Konami replied, we're not sure what kind of thing this was. Which is,
God,
a really great response. Also, maybe translated from Japanese. I'm getting most of this. This is a Kotaku article that I'm kind of pulling this from. And also, the Konami claims that currently Kojima is listed as a company employee. So, nah, like, that dude's gone.
Even Konami's if he's just, like, really bitter about
it. Like, maybe he is, like, they already decided, like, hey, I'm leaving in January. By the way, I got all this vacation time built up. I'm going to take it right now. Like, maybe he is going on vacation. But that guy's also done.
Yeah, that guy's outie.
Which, good for him.
Yeah.
They burned him, so, like, leave. Take your vacation time. Drink out of white cups with your development team.
Yep.
And then bounce, man. Good for you.
You earned it. You know what we need to talk about?
What?
That NX article that came out
last week. Oh, I vaguely remember this.
Okay. So, it's really, well, really quick. Wall Street Journal put out a article about how Nintendo started to deliver development kits to developers.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's the thing that I always wanted.
Oh, since when?
Since the Wii U. Which was...
okay.
They say... let's see, where is it? The exact shape of the NX hardware isn't clear yet. People familiar with the development plans have said Nintendo would likely include both a console and at least one mobile unit that could be either used in conjunction with the console or taken on the road for separate use.
Bonkers, dude.
They also said Nintendo would aim to put industry-leading chips in the NX devices after the criticism that the Wii U's capabilities didn't match those of competitors. So, like, this is the thing that I've always wanted, which is like, a really good Nintendo console that I can also put in my pocket.
I just want a portable system that has one screen.
You might be getting that.
I also want to have a... I want to be able to play Game Boy Advance games on a portable system.
I don't know about that, but...
That'd be cool, though.
I'm super stoked. About all of this.
It is very exciting.
Yeah. So, NX Hype Train... starts, I suppose.
Yeah, I guess we'll have to see exactly what this shapes up into, but based on that, either this is like the craziest red herring ever, because it sounds a little bit too good to be true.
It does.
Or Nintendo's got their shit together. Or it's just going to cost like $600.
It might.
Which would be really unfortunate.
Yeah, most kids don't got $600, so...
Luckily, I'm not a kid, and I don't know. I mean, that's a very interesting idea. It's going to come down to the application of exactly how the systems interlock, and, like, what is it, like, does the system that it's docking into, is it significantly more powerful, or, like, it's weird to think that there's such a thing as, like, a game... that it'll look good on your TV, but so requires so little power, like processing power, that you can also put it in your pocket.
Yeah.
Which is kind of like the reason why the Wii U exists, is because they didn't, like, technology does not exist to make that thing fully portable. It's got to look good on your TV. You can make it look good on, like, a smaller screen, but you can't take that screen very far from the computing power.
Right.
Unless it just, like, docks into, like the main CPU docks into, like, a bunch of extra RAM and, like, another video card, like, in the base. And that's what makes it look better. But, like, man, that seems complicated, and that's probably a nightmare to develop for.
I don't know.
Anyway you shake it.
So, there's that.
I just wanted to mention it. It made me super jazzed to think about. So, like, if Nintendo just made one thing, I'd be super stoked. Like, just, this is the Nintendo thing. You play Nintendo games on it. Super stoked.
Yeah, I would love, I want to play more Nintendo games.
I love Nintendo games.
Yeah, me too. It's a bit there aren't any more this year.
Yeah, they're done. All over. No more Nintendo games.
Because Fatal Frame, the Maiden of Blackwater came out just 2 days from now. When, as you listen to this, you can buy Fatal Frame, the Maiden of Blackwater. And that's it for the year. But it's been a pretty good year for Nintendo.
This is the only year so far where I felt like the Wii U really kind of came into its own.
Splatoon, Super Mario Maker, game over.
Yeah.
And Smash Bros. Was last November or something, right? Or like earlier than that. It was last year, though. Yeah, it was. Yes,
yeah, it was. It was. I don't remember.
Smash Bros. Is great, but I don't think it's as good as some of these newer. And Pikmin 4 is coming.
Yeah, dude.
Like, I think next year. Unofficially. But, like, that makes me a little bit concerned that it's going to be too samey as to 3. But 3 was good.
I liked Pikmin
3. I'd probably play a little bit more 3. I should probably beat 3.
I need to beat 3. I'm on the last boss.
Hey, speaking of 3.
Podcast over?
Bear vs. Man, Extra Life.
Oh, shit.
24-hour stream.
It's happening.
2015,
it's happening November 7th.
November 7th, 8 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We will be playing video games.
Mm-hmm. A lot of them. We have a schedule.
We nailed down like a pretty basic schedule that we will probably not follow that closely because no one wants to be the guy being like, it's 6 o'clock. We got to stop playing Gang Beasts. Okay, you guys? I know it's fun.
Fuck
we have
you,
to
Nick.
Stop.
You're a piece of shit.
Yeah, it's like, oh, all right, I guess we're... Because nobody wants to play Keep Talking and Nobody Explodes.
We will play that on stream.
I realize that might be weird because you can't... Like, if you're the one of the people with the instructions, you're not supposed to be able to see the bomb.
You don't think I got this shit on lock? I got this shit on lock.
Not necessarily. You're just going to, like...
I have another small monitor that is on a coffee table. And then you just sit on a little couch by yourself.
And then it'll... okay. That mm-hmm. that might work.
That'll definitely work. I did it.
It's just crazy enough to work. Do you have the rules printed out?
Of course I do. What do you think? I'm some kind of heathen?
Dope.
You think I'm some kind of stupid idiot?
So exciting. Sometimes you act like one.
Yeah, that's true.
But, like, that's just life, man.
That's me, man.
Yeah, no, let's everybody do that. And we're going to have a Mario Party during Extra Life because we're crazy and we hate ourselves.
So we're gonna do a thing where we kind of hate ourselves while we do the whole thing for 24 hours straight, and then we're gonna do a thing in the middle where we definitely hate ourselves.
We're gonna so right now we have it scheduled to start at 10 o'clock p.m.
Yeah.
So basically, by the time we're done with that, it's gonna just be the worst
because it's gonna be so bad.
It's gonna be late. We're gonna be tired. And we're just gonna be like, no, I don't even want to. Mario Party. Killed my want to play any more games.
Oh, dude, you put Kirby's Air Ride in here? Fuck.
Yeah, but if we got a little bit of time left over while the GameCube or whatever is still plugged in, we'll play some Air Ride. I like that game.
Air Ride sucks.
But we got, why don't we play City Ride mode? Everybody likes City Ride.
I don't like that game at all.
Alright, so we'll play Mario Power Tennis there instead. I don't know, put some dumbass GameCube game in there. It's 4 players.
I don't fucking know, dude. Shit.
Jerk. Yeah, but we got some combinations of games. Like the beginning block is gonna be people playing some goofy PC games, hopefully. We got a bunch of our favorite couch competitive games queued up, and we'll just kinda cycle through those as we kinda feel like it. Playing some Jackbox Party Pack 2 for sure. I don't know when that's gonna happen, but that is gonna happen. I also had this idea to make Ryan play some spoopy games, some scary games.
I like to get spoopy.
And I don't know, like, I don't even know, like, we have to find games that are going to be spooky within, like, 30 minutes to an hour, though.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking Penumbra Overture, because I've been pressuring him to play that for a long time.
You have.
That wouldn't be scary, like, in that period of time. It's like a slow burn. So, Five Nights at Freddy's would probably work. Did you play the fourth one yet?
I don't own it.
You should buy it for, like, $6 and play it.
Okay.
But yeah, and then we just got, like, a mishmash, if you're... For some reason, some freaks are watching us. Like, maybe you're in like, a different country. Maybe you're in Saudi Arabia and you're watching. You tune in. Like, when you wake up in the morning, it just so happens to be 4:30 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, and we're just playing some goofy stuff, trying to stay awake. Mm-hmm. But it's going to be Ryan and myself and Joe. We're in it for the long haul. There'll be some special guests along the way.
It's true.
We're gonna
film a podcast in the middle of it.
Yep. Yeah, we are. Kind of like we did with our 12-hour stream,
because
I thought that was pretty good. So we're gonna just assume we're gonna do that again because it was cool and it saves us the trouble of having to do it separately.
Fact.
Yeah, so that's gonna be fun, and we're raising money. So the whole point of Extra Life, you guys don't know, Extra Life is it's a charity organization, and when you do these marathon streams, you try and. It's sort of the equivalent of doing, like, the walk for breast cancer. So instead of saying, I'm going to walk 3 miles, and for every mile I walk, I want you guys to pledge $2. Say, I'm going to sit on my butt and play 24 hours of video games, and then you guys should give me money, and that money is going to go directly to a local hospital to benefit, usually, or cancer research organization or something like that that benefits, like, sick kids. So we're specifically doing it for Boston Children's Hospital. Any money that we raise is going to go right to them. And I really hope that you guys can, you know, if you guys are in a position to be able to pitch in a little bit, go for it. Give us something to keep going for. We talk to our friends and family and stuff, and hopefully, you know, get some viewers and raise a little bit of money for a good cause. Yeah. Have a little bit of fun along the way. That sounds like a good time, right?
Yeah.
So that's November 7th. There'll be one more podcast before then, so you will be hearing about this again.
Mm-hmm.
In case you're just like, oh, but remember what they said when it was, just wait for the next one. We got you. But we also have a presence on the internet in the meantime, if you just want more. We're on iTunes. If you're listening to this on iTunes, take a moment to give us a review. It helps spread the word. If we ever get enough reviews in a short period of time, we can get a new and noteworthy. That'd be massive.
That'd be sick.
But ultimately, that's not going to happen unless we spread the word. So if you're listening to this podcast and you don't think it's the dumbest thing ever, find a friend who you think might like video games and let them know about us. We are on iTunes. That's like kind of probably one of the better ways to do it. But, you know, we're on SoundCloud. Stitcher. Yep. So are we still doing Stitcher?
As far as I know, right, yeah.
Tech guy, you tell him about the stuff.
Yeah, we're on Twitter.
Yeah, we're on Vine.
Tweeted us. We make Vines once in a while. I made a funny Vine, but it was on my own account.
That was a pretty good Vine. I like that Vine.
The guy that when I tagged Carl from online. I wrote IB, and then I put it on Twitter, and then he favorited it, so I felt pretty good.
Oh man, he's a big fan.
I know he's me and Carl from online are pretty.
You should probably talk to Carl from online about telling his friends about Bear vs. Mancast leaving an iTunes review. What else do we do? We do Twitter. We
have a Facebook. Hey, you just made us a Pinterest.
I did, but there's nothing really happening there yet.
Oh well, you're a piece of shit.
I just did it like very recently. We have a Twitch. We stream on Twitch when Ryan's computer isn't broken.
I fixed it.
He's good now, okay. So we're gonna be good for the extra. It's just twitch.tv/bearvsman. Bear vs. Man.
It is.
Like everything else at Bear vs. Man. If you've got
send us a fucking email.
Yeah, definitely do that because it's 2001 and emails are cool.
Send us an email if you want us to talk about something that you care about on the show.
Questions@bearvsman.com.
That's true. That's the place you can go.
Bearvsman.com. Yeah.
That's 100% accurate.
It is. I think that's it. That's it. Facebook, Twitter, got all the big ones. Bearversusband.com.
That's a website.
We do some light editorial stuff there.
We do whatever we feel like. Let's get real here.
Yeah, whenever we feel like it, we just do that.
We wrote some reviews a couple weeks ago.
Maybe we'll write some more in a couple weeks. Who knows?
I might. All right, that's it.
Remember, guys. Deep D Skilly Goo. So hang. Keep it one on it. Deep D Skilly.
Deep Dish Skillet Cookie.